haven't changed, had much to say. But man, I still think them cats are crazy. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. I told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy.
We've had sort of like quite a bit of time off, and all these other bands have been hugging the line like, well, I've been away. I suppose it's like, it's just coming back and saying, right, move over now, you know. Big boys are back.
We were tired, yeah, we were knackered. I mean, we, you know, sit down and think, what's going on? Check it out, what did he really think of us? And what do I really think of myself? And it was nice to have that time off, it was good. It was nice to go, it was like a little bit of a prison sentence, you know what I mean? It was nice, just an hour off, full fit and mad for it, you know what I mean? And now everyone's going to get it again.
Yeah. You come out and wear it, mate. Please. Okay, mate. Do you understand? I've got something on both of them anyway.
No. Yeah. If you come out and wear it, mate.
You've never been here before, have you?
Oh, that's right.
Well, apart from that,
this is a stage.
Well, I mean, you've never been here for other than professional fair.
I don't think we'll ever better them gigs. It's just the atmosphere.
When we played the gig, that's, if you look up there, that's where the dressing rooms were. Mine was number 25 there. Alan's is 26, Griggs is 27, and Arliam had the rest of them. he had five for all his choice, different personalities that he went through on that particular day.
The first time all our families have been able to come and see us and not have to sit in the crowd, they all got, you know, little boxes and stuff like that. And it was at Main Road. That is, I mean, you know, if you, when you sit down and think about things like that, it's like, you know.
As walkouts go, this was one of the best. After a triumphant summer playing to hundreds of thousands of British fans, mega band Oasis were off to delight the Americans, until lead singer and national heartthrob Liam Gallagher decided to get off his Chicago-bound plane to sort out moving house.
I'd never let the band down. I didn't have an house to live in for the start, you know what I mean? I was living in hotels in America, and I'd come back to England, and I was going to live in another hotel for another 4 months. It's like, it's not that important, you know what I mean? You need a home.
Hello, is Mr. Gallagher there, please?
Who is it?
It's, is that Liam?
Yeah.
Hello, Liam, it's Jeremy Vine from Newsnight here. How are you doing?
I'm f***ing sound, how are you?
Not bad, are you coming out?
I'm a f***, it's raining, mate.
Why aren't you going to Chicago? Hello, Liam.
Liam, what are you going to say about the rumours that the band are on the verge of breaking up?
Breaking down,
that's it. Breaking down, mate?
Yeah.
We're breaking down.
Who's that?
Noel Gallagher arrived at Heathrow tonight amid speculation that abruptly abandoning Oasis American tour two-thirds through was a prelude to breakup. He wouldn't answer questions about the future.
Is it the end for Oasis?
It just seems to be a never-ending circle of work. And of course everyone was, you know, trying to squeeze as much life out of Morning Glories as possible before the band imploded.
Yeah, I think 3 years without any sort of break of more than a week, 10 days. and that was constantly touring or recording.
I had just about enough, and I said, if this is what it is, you know, then I'm not going to be in a band. And everybody said, well, let's just do one record, put it out, and then, you know, we'll see what happens. So I said, all right, well, I agreed to go back and do the record. So we rented a big farmhouse out in Surrey somewhere, and I went there, and it was just sort of like all the lads together, and, you know, just went out and got pissed for 2 days, I think. And then we, you know, we just like sit up all night and record and play music. And then we decided that we wanted to carry on the band and get back into it.
Well, I was getting, every time we'd come to record, I was getting followed by like four cars outside my house waiting for me. If they choose to follow me back, that's fine, you know what I mean? But as soon as I got in here, you know, it's like I'm back, you know, I'm back with the boys and that, and down at work, they can't come in. You know what I mean? They just fizzle away.
Another thing that came out of going to Ridge Farm is that now we know that we're doing this for the right reasons, which is we want it. We don't need to do it. We don't need to be in a band. We don't need, you know, to go on world tours and all the rest of it and all the hassle that comes with that. We don't need to do it. We're doing it now because we want to. It was like starting a new band, you know, because we were doing a brand new album. There was no pressure on us. We weren't told when to start or when to finish. And it was going in there, and it was like, right, well, you know, we did feel a bit, you know, like, oh, it was us against the world. Everybody had written us off, and how can a band like that still survive? And with the drugs and all the rest of it. This is probably going to be the most important album of our career, really. This is the one that's either going to send us, you know, to U2 sort of like levels, or it's going to be the one that's, you know, probably see us back on the dole. Nothing better than the best album of 1997 is good enough for us. You know, we want to blow every other band into oblivion. As simple as that. Still do, you know. Still want to just eclipse every single musician in this country. Because we want to, because we can, because we're the best.
Get a lager. Hey! OK, let's do it. Step off the train on a lone at dawn, back into the home where I was born. Sun in the sky never raised an eye to me. They put on the tracks and they must be mine. Through on the hill and I feel fine. Don't look back cause you know what you might see.
Quite low.
Okay. So everybody here, make sure everything's tied down. And if it's blow away, we'll blow away.
The reason why the majority of the people in this country like my band is because we are like the majority of the people in this country. You know, we still go to football matches, we still go to the pub.
And here at the Crucible Theatre?
We do get nicked and busted and stuff like that, like everybody else does, you know. We're still outspoken and we still don't give a shit. I wouldn't say we're the voice of a generation, but we'd definitely be leading a march. If there's anywhere to march to, I think we'd be at the front, singing.
I think rock and roll's about a lifestyle. It's got to be, hasn't it? No one wants goody goody boy, do they? In rock and roll, wouldn't work. The songs wouldn't work for a start. You wouldn't be able to get that anger out in a song. You got to live it, haven't you? Got to, haven't you? You just got to have a good time. Even the guy in the butcher, you know, he could be rock and roll. You know what I mean? The guy in the butcher's shop, you know what I mean?
Not really, not unless you fancy the boardwalks. The venue,
isn't it? No, I just live my life the way I want to live it. I want to have fun. You know what I mean? Everyone has a fair share of fun. Sure, you have your fair share of fun, don't you? You look as if you do. You've got fun, haven't you? How the fuck, right, could I not have fun? I'm 24 years of age in the biggest rock and roll band in the bleeding world, or the most important rock and roll band in the world. Because the biggest don't matter about being big, does it? Most important rock and roll band in the world. How could I not have fun? 24 years of age, I've got a load of money. I went to do sit at home and bleeding, clip me pissing toenails and pick my nose all day. Got to go out and have it, haven't you? Because you'd have it, wouldn't you? So, come on!
These beyond protection, that lad. If you tell Liam not to put his head in the fire, then he will. I mean, if you advise him not to do something, then he's going to go and do it. So, you just got to let him go on with it. The reason why they pick on him is because he goes around punching photographers in the face, you know. Now, I sort of look at this logically. It's like, I mean, I don't like having my photograph taken when I'm out and about out of town, but, you know, if you're going to go and smack, you know, a photographer in the face who works for the News of the World, and he's going to go and tell his editor, he's going to go, did he really now? Right, we'll have that bastard. So, but he can handle it. I mean, well, he says he can anyway. So. But he courts it more than anyone.
Been a bit strange. I mean, for me personally, I don't get it. So I'm like a fortunate one in the band. Gwig's the bass player, Alan. They don't get it. Not on a scale like Liam and Noel get it. But yeah, it's weird sometimes when you read the paper and you know they're telling you what Liam had last night for dinner. You know, he had a Chinese takeaway and he had egg fried rice, but Patsy had an Indian.
Liam gets a lot of pressure from what he does. You know, he has people camping out his door every 5 minutes. I mean, you have to be quite strong to put up with that, don't you?
No hearts. Right,
yes.
Ocean court last night.
It was good. Yeah? Yeah. I'm not, you know, I'm not an hooligan. I don't go around picking fights with people. I just like to get on with my own business, you know what I mean? But the way they write and the way I'm portrayed and that, yeah, it's like as if, yeah, he wants to fight 24 hours of the day, and I don't want to fight.
Leave you alone.
Nobody knows.
it's gonna be, yeah. Maybe I can see, yeah. But don't you know the cold and wind and rain? Don't know, they only seem to come and go away. It's gonna be. Stand by me. And nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
Yeah, nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
The way it's gonna be.
Oh, the atmosphere's gone out of this ground now. When I used to start coming in, the capacity then was about 85,000 then. This used to be the old Kippax stand, which was the largest stand in England. It was the last one to be knocked down as well. And right on this corner here was where I do believe I watched my first Man City game from. About halfway up the top. And it was 1971. Those were the good old days. From what I can remember, there was like a ledge there where all the dads used to come with the sons, plonk them on the ledge and then go on the piss down the bar here. And then just leave the sons there. So we used to go to away matches regularly, didn't we?
Yeah, all of them. In the mid-80s.
Yeah. I think there was one season where we went to every single game of versus. Still quite proud of that. Something like 50-odd games. There's about 20 of us. You're probably watching this after you're like, Owsie and Tatey and all them lot. How are you doing anyway? If I wasn't doing what I was doing now, I'd probably be... Well, I wouldn't say I'd be a footballer, but I'd probably have hopes of being a footballer. But that's all there is around these parts, really. If you can't play guitar and you can't play football, there's not a lot else, really, to get into in the city. You know, if you're not academically educated or anything like that.
Everyone gets told they're worthless, don't they? You know what I mean? You got to go and prove it, haven't you? No one gives you a chance in this world, do they? You've always got some knob to start putting you down, haven't you? Until the day you fucking die, there's always going to be someone who's thinking you think you're a dick, isn't there? You just got to go and get in your own world and sort it out. And maybe one day they'll sit up and listen. Because you've got to go out and do it for yourself, haven't you? You ain't got daddy feeding your pockets all the time, have you? And mummy. You've got to go out and do it yourself, man. I think it's easier coming... I won't say easier, but, you know... It gives you a sense of... I don't know, I'm not that good with words, but it gives you that... Come on. I've got to go and do something for myself.
Well, even when, you know, you go and see your careers officer, you know. Liam told me he wanted to be a pop star. When he went to see his careers officer, can you imagine that? And he said, no, you know, thou shalt work at Ford or McVitie's. And he was going, and he asked me what I wanted to do. He said, I want to be in a band, I want to be a pop star. And he kicked him out.
I said, a rock and roll star. He says, you can't be that. I said, right, then a lumberjack. Get me a fucking job as a lumberjack, chopping trees down. And then I went back about 3 months later and said, yeah, can I sign off? And he went, why is that then? I went, because I'm a rock and roll star. I've got a 6-album deal to write.
We're going out. Coyle is our ex-sound engineer, but he won't have it in the house, so he'll have to wait outside for us where we're going to have a cup of tea with the lads.
Because he's a bit deaf.
Because he's a bit moody like that.
He's a grumpy old fart, in fact.
Yeah. He used to be our sound engineer and he went deaf. Imagine that. And he actually mixed the sound at Glastonbury while he was deaf, so that's why it was double loud. Oh, you trivia buffs.
So what does he do now?
He just walks around the house going, you what?
With a beat. He's got them big Indian drum beat, right. Them drum skin things, just walking around.
Right going, this
next right, not this one, in this lane. You used to live down there?
Yeah, I used to live down there. That's good enough. This is where we spent our total childhoods round here. This is where
he's just knocking about round here. You just get your side, you just go down the back there and drop a load of acid down the back there.
I got caught shoplifting in that co-op round back the there, back man. There. That's when I first got caught.
Load of magic mushrooms round there, laugh your head off round there.
That's a top chippy. One second. Eddie Yates opened that chippy. That used to be a cafe on that. Remember that, the eyeball cafe?
There's a record shop there. Not as good as Sifters, but it was alright. Used to have some good old Wolf Tones records in there. And over there, that's where all the students are. See that on that poster there? That's me. See me? Yeah, me. There's me. Yeah, me and our kid and the band, man. And in there, there's all the students. It's all the students filled out.
This is, man, coming up to the park here now. Here's the park where we always played football as kids. That's where the fair used to be. It's this where we met Gwiggs and Bonehead and the other geezer.
Yeah, this is where we used to come off.
Yeah.
Thing of us.
When you meet people from outside Manchester who come here for the weekend or come here for a week, they go, oh, it's all right up in Manchester, it's out. But if you lived there for 25 years of your life, man, it's quite boring, really. There's not much to it, I don't think, anyway.
It's a bit small.
It's
only the people that are good.
Small. Yeah, the people are good, but the actual place itself is boring, man. People are top, man. I miss not being near my mum, that's what I miss.
Straight up here, on the right up here, is McVitie's where Mum used to work.
The big biscuit factory.
We used to knock about in the park, she'd work here, we'd meet her from the park, say about 11 at night.
Walk her home.
And walk her home with a load of biscuits. Big boxes of Jaffa cakes, we used to sort of penguins. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We went through bad times, you know, and all that stuff, and she was always like, I don't know, she just. I don't know. You know, there was a lot of shit going on. And you just had to, you know, I don't know, this is all for her, you know, I'm doing it for her at the moment. Well, I always will do, you know what I mean? Be proud of me. She knows who I am. She knows I'm not that thing they write about.
My mum always drummed in, it was that we were no different and we were no better or we were no worse than anybody else. We were just the same as everybody else and whatever we wanted in life, we could go and get it, you know. If we believed in it enough. She was right, weren't you?
Scary, better now. It's getting better now. It's getting better now.